العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين والصلاة والسلام على أنبياء الله جميعا وعلى سيدهم وخاتمهم حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
اللهم صل على
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم فاصبر على ما يقولون وسبح بحمد ربك قبل طلوع الشمس وقبل غروبها ومن آناء الليل فسبح وأطراف النهار لعلك ترضى صدق الله العلي العظيم. One of the issues that we face in our community, in many communities who live in the West, in Europe, in North America, is the ideological divide of the family. What does that mean? It means that we see sometimes families that some of them are converts, they converted to Islam, and some of them are still non-Muslims. And also we see some families that some of them are devout, religious, practicing Muslims. They respect their faith, they practice their faith. And some members in the same house, in the same family, in the same room, who are not practicing. They don't practice Islam. They are not devout. Some of them don't even believe in Islam, let alone practicing it. So we have this divide. This religious divide, ideological divide. We have it in many families. And I have seen some mothers, some fathers, sometimes some children who tell me that I am tortured at home, not physically, but mentally, because I try to guide my family, to advise them, to uphold to their religious principles, religious ideals, religious practices, but they make fun of me. They disrespect my faith. They disrespect me because I pray, because I fast, because I observe hijab, because I read the Quran. And we have this conflict. And it's a torture for me. It's a torture. And I have seen many parents, sometimes fathers, sometimes mothers, sometimes children, who are contemplating on running away from the family because they are not enjoying their time. When you live with a partner who does not share the same belief with you, not only does not share the same belief, he makes fun of you. Everything you say, everything you do, he makes fun of it. He ridicules you. He calls you an outdated person, a backward person, a person who still lives in the dark ages. And then you have a conflict. You have a confrontation every single day. You have a confrontation. Then, of course, that life would not be a peaceful life. That life would be very painful and takes a toll on you mentally, probably physically, socially. And it really makes some people run away from the family. Run away. Try to find another sanctuary, another place where they are welcomed, or at least another place where they can practice their religion freely. This is why I always advise the newlywed, those who are thinking of getting married, I always say this, always, always, I advise them that you have to marry someone who shares the same belief with you. Being in love with that individual is not enough. Being in love is just a romance. But you have to share the ideological system, the belief system too. Even the practicing of the ideology, not just to believe in it, but to practice it. You have to share the same. If you don't, you're going to pay the price. In the near future, you're going to pay the price. You're going to see these divisions, they start to surface, and they start to go deeper and deeper, and one day, you find yourself in the court, standing before the judge. So, what do we do? What does Islam say? Islam says that there are some people who live with you, probably members of your own family, your own extended family, neighbors, close friends, who are, they are not Muslims, but they have nothing against Islam. They are non-hostile. They respect your religion. They respect. They don't share it with you, but they respect your belief. And they don't propagate, neither provoke, nor work against you. There is a clear-cut injunction vis-a-vis this group, this peaceful group, who do not share the religion with you, but they don't hurt you. They respect your tradition. And we see many of them in our neighborhood. We see many of them. In the circle of our friends and friendship, we see many of them. I know many Christians, I personally know them, that during this Ramadan, they are fasting. Some of them, they fast for a few days, some of them, they fast the whole month in sympathy and respect to the Muslim community. This is something great. This is, we are really proud of. We have to cherish this. You live in a country that there are some people who don't share your Islam with you, but yet they respect you and they go a long way of sympathizing with you, fasting the month of Ramadan. And of course, Allah says, I'm not going to waste their deeds. فَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَهُ. Every good deed, whether big or small, it's going to give its positive fruits. Every bad deed, whether big or small, is going to give its bad fruits. Those Allah says about them in Surah Al-Mumtahana, chapter 60, in the Holy Quran, لَا يَنْهَاكُمُ اللَّهُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ لَمْ يُقَاتِلُوكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ وَلَمْ يُخْرِجُوكُمْ مِنْ دِيَارِكُمْ أَنْ تَبَرُّوهُمْ وَتُقْسِطُوا إِلَيْهِمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ. Chapter 60, I want you to memorize this verse. Chapter 60, verse number 8. You who live in the West, Muslims who live in the West, they have to memorize this verse. When the Christians ask you about, what do you believe of us? What do you believe of non-Muslims? Say to them this verse. Chapter 60, verse 8, ayah number 8. Read this verse. لَا يَنْهَاكُمُ اللَّهُ. God does not forbid you to do good, to be good and kind to those non-Muslims who did not fight against you. لَمْ يُقَاتِلُكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ. They did not fight you because you are Muslim, because of your religious orientation. وَلَمْ يُخْرِجُكُمْ مِنْ دِيَارِكُمْ. They did not harass you and drive you out of your land, your house. وَلَمْ يُخْرِجُكُمْ مِنْ دِيَارِكُمْ. مِنْ دِيَارِكُمْ أَنْ it means you must. أَنْ تَبَرُّوهُمْ. تَبَرُّوهُمْ, comes from birr, and birr is a dutifulness. Al-birru bil-walidain comes from the same root. The same way you treat your parents, al-birru bil-walidain, being dutiful, kind to your parents, you do the same to those people who are your friends. And maybe your family members sometimes. Your in-laws, sometimes the blood related to you. أَلْتَبَرُّوهُمْ وَتُقْسِطُوا إِلَيْهِمْ. Wow, تُقْسِطُوا. I could not find a better word. No better word in the Arabic dictionary in expressing compassion and respect than this term, تُقْسِطُوا. What is the root of تُقْسِطُوا, my friends? Huh?
Qist.
And what is Qist? Qist is the highest level of what?
Justice.
Because justice has levels. The highest level of justice is this. The Quran says in Surah Al-Hadid, لَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلَنَا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأَنْزَلْنَا مَعَهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْمِيزَانَ لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ. We want people to act with qist. Their attitude is based on qist, the highest level of justice and firmness and kindness. So Allah says those Christians, those Jews, those whatever Buddhists, Hindus, whatever religion they have, if they do not harass you, if they respect you, respect them. Be kind to them. Be hospitable to them. Try also to understand them and appreciate what they have. This is what we have to do. Now suppose there are some people who, other two groups, so this is the first group, people who are non-Muslims but they are peaceful. We have to deal with them with birr and qist, with kindness and utmost justice and firmness. There are other two groups. The second group are those who want to fight against you. Not only they don't tolerate you, not only they don't accept you, but they plot to murder you, to kill you. In this case, Allah says, do not take them as friends. Those are not just your enemies, they are the enemies of God too. لا تتخذوا عدوي وعدوكم أولياء تلقون إليهم بالمودة. Don't take such people who harbor so much grudge and hate and they plot to destroy you, to eradicate you. Don't take them as friends. لا تلقون إليهم بالمودة. Do not show them humility or affection because they want to destroy you. So there is no way you can be good to them. Stay away from those. Don't take them as friends. And you have to be firm with those people. Because they are not only against you, they are against God. Why do they hate you? Not because of something personal, but because you are a Muslim. If you tell them, I'm not a Muslim, they are not going to hate you. We have this among the Muslim community and the Muslim society, we have this. Once he knows you are Shi'a, he disrespects you. But if you tell him, I'm not a Shi'a, then you are okay, you are a human being. So he has nothing personal against you. He's against your faith, against your iman, against your religion, against your God. This is the problem. And this is prejudice. This is ignorance. Sometimes it's prejudice. He knows the truth, but he cannot change his heart. He can't. You see, sometimes some people, when you try to advise them about smoking, not smoking, he knows more than what you know. He knows about the harms and the dangers of smoking more what you know, more than what you know. But he cannot give up. He cannot change. Some people, they know about the danger of drinking alcohol more than what you know, but you cannot change. The same thing with aqidah, with ideology. Some people know they are mistaken. They know their path is wrong. They know very well. This is in the Quran. وَجَحَدُوا بِهَا. God who creates us, He knows our psychology. He knows how we think. He knows our psychology. Allah says, وَجَحَدُوا بِهَا وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسُهُمْ ظُلْمًا وَعُلُوًا. Deep inside, they know the truth, but they still reject the truth. جَحَدُوا بِهَا. They reject. Why? Because of arrogance. Some people are arrogant. They do not confess that they are wrong. They don't want to confess. This is the mentality of jahiliyyah. So this is one. Prejudice is very dangerous. And we have this prejudice in every society, including the United States of America. Do you know, after the incident of Charleston 2 weeks ago, until now, more than 10 black churches were burnt in the southern states. Every single day, there is 2 or 3 black churches are burnt through arson, an act of arson, just because those people are black. And imagine the one who burns the church is a Christian. And he is a churchgoer too. He goes to a church. But then he comes and he burns another church. Because that church belongs to the black people. We have the same thing. There are some people who kill the Shi'as. He goes to the mosque. He worships God. But he destroys the Shi'a mosque because this guy is a Shi'a. Do you see the prejudice here? So we have it. We have it in America, we have it in Saudi Arabia, we have it in the East, we have it in the West, we have it in all cultures and in all religions. This is prejudice, ta'assub. This is exactly what the Quran says. وَجَحَدُوا بِهَا وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسُهُمْ ظُلْمًا وَعُلُوًا. They know the truth, but they reject it as an act of wrongdoing and as an act of arrogance. Uluwwan. We do have this. This is a disease. Someone who is muta'assib, someone who has a prejudice, he or she has a disease. They have to correct themselves. They have to cure themselves. This is a disease. This is number one. Sometimes it's not prejudice. It is what? Ignorance. They don't know the truth. But if you tell them the truth, they give up. They don't hate you. So there are reasons for this hate. There are reasons. Sometimes prejudice, sometimes ignorance. Allah says those who fight you and they want to kill you and murder you, don't have a friendship with them. Don't. إِنَّمَا يَنْهَاكُمْ. Again in the same chapter, 60. Allah says, we do not forbid you from being kind to those non-Muslims who are good. Be kind to them. But we forbid you to be kind with those non-Muslims who are against you. إِنَّمَا يَنْهَاكُمُ اللَّهُ. Listen to the wording of the Quran. عَنِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُوكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ. Those who fight you based on religious grounds. Because you are Muslim, they fight. يُقَاتِلُوكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ. This is number one. إِنَّمَا يَنْهَاكُمُ اللَّهُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ قَاتَلُوكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ وَأَخْرَجُوكُمْ مِنْ دِيَارِكُمْ. They driven you out of your land. وَظَاهَرُوا عَلَىٰ إِخْرَاجِكُمْ. Not only they drove you out of your land, but they supported and backed the groups who drove you out, or who drove you out of your land. You know this guy who murdered 8 or 9 people in the black church in South Carolina? What's his name? Something ends with roof, something like that. Although he's roofless, alhamdulillah. You know how much money they raised for him? People who have a prejudice, people who are like-minded, people who are like-minded like him, how much money they raised for him to support him. So those, they could not do the crime, but they help someone who does the crime. They support him, they encourage him. This is exactly what Allah says. وَظَاهَرُوا عَلَىٰ إِخْرَاجِكُمْ. They cannot drive you out, but they raise money for those who drive you out. And we have in many Muslim countries, we have people who cannot join ISIS, but they raise money for ISIS. They send money, they send supply. Politically, they support that. There was a survey, recent survey, go and check it out. It was published 3 days ago. 95% of the tweets, 95% of the youth, 95% of the youth who tweet in Saudi Arabia, they support ISIS. 95%. A recent survey. Who studied those who tweet in support of ISIS, they found out, they tracked them down into their countries, Saudi Arabia is number one. They support ISIS. And we have some of them from here, they tweet from America, supporting ISIS. ISIS, which goes against every basic fundamental of Islam. Did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, did he encourage people to bomb, to kill others, to kill worshippers inside the mosque, inside the church, in the marketplace, in the school? Did he do that? Did the Prophet Muhammad was beheading people and burning them in a fire based on their ideology? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam always reached out to others. قُلْ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ تَعَالَوْ come to me, I welcome you. He reached out to others. He extended his hand, his heart to others. To the extent that he married a lady who was Jewish, another lady who was Christian. Previously they were Jewish and Christian, and he married them. They became part of his family. Safiya was Jewish. Maria al-Qibtiyya was Christian. They became part of the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Where is ISIS now? Who do they follow? They do not follow Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They follow the mentality, the path of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, the founder of Wahhabism. Not Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Allah says, those who drive you out and they back others and they support others to drive you out, don't extend the hand of friendship with them. They are your enemies, and they are the enemies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قَدْ كَانَتْ لَكُمْ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ فِي إِبْرَاهِيمِ. We take Ibrahim alayhi salam, the forefather of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as an example. أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ فِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهْ إِذْ قَالُوا لِقَوْمِهِمْ. They said to their community who had prejudice against them and who ultimately drove Ibrahim out of Iraq. Ibrahim is a man who was born in Iraq, Iraqi, Nasiriyah. If you go today to Iraq, there is a city called Nasiriyah in the southern part of Iraq, between Baghdad and Basra, somewhere in the middle, Nasiriyah. Outside Nasiriyah, it's the birthplace of Ibrahim alayhi salam. They drove him out of the country. Go. They stripped him out of his Iraqi nationality, as some countries they do nowadays, with the believers. The government of Bahrain does this. The government of Qatar does this. The Emirati government does this. They stripped some people out of their nationality, and he remains stateless. He doesn't know. He doesn't know where is he. In the middle of the ocean. Because he does not support the government. So Ibrahim was stripped out of his nationality, and he was driven out. He was driven out because he spoke the truth. Because he spoke the truth. Not because he was a terrorist. Because he invited his community to worship God, to be good, not to abuse each other. إذ إنا براء منكم ومما تعبدون من دون الله. Ibrahim and those of you who believed with him, he said to his own community who are declaring war against him, war and violence against him, إنا براء. We disconnect ourselves from you. We can't be your friends anymore. I am your friend if you respect me, but if you want to murder me, how can I be your friend? Friendship is based on love and a trust, isn't it? These are the, you know, ingredients of friendship. When you have someone as a friend, you have to respect him. Even if you differ with that person, even if you differ with them, you have to respect their traditions, their ideologies. But if you say to someone, you are my friend, but you disrespect him, not only disrespecting him, you wait for the minute that you can murder that person and destroy him, then this is not friendship. Don't fool yourself. Don't be friend of those enemies. So this is the second group. The first group are non-Muslims who are peaceful. Second are non-Muslims or even Muslims who are not peaceful, who are dangerous. You cannot be their friends. Now we come to the third group. Third group are Muslims. They say we are Muslims, but they don't practice Islam. And if you are a member of their family, they don't allow you to practice Islam. They harass you. I know some girls who belong to some Muslim families. When they observe hijab, their mothers become frustrated with them, rather than becoming happy and appreciative of them and saying, mashallah, you are doing something good, you are protecting yourself, protecting your dignity, getting closer to God. The mother starts harassing her daughter. The father, who knows his son is going to the mosque during the month of Ramadan and learning Quran and learning Islam and getting close to God and trying to fix it himself, the father becomes angry with his son, rather than saying, I'm proud of you, son. I'm really proud of you. You don't go to nightclubs. You don't waste your time in the streets. You don't do drugs. You go to the mosque. You work on yourself. The father becomes angry. And they discourage their children from practicing Islam. We do. We do have many examples of this. Many examples. So what do you do? As I said, sometimes life is really hell with those people. You cannot enjoy your life. When your family are not sharing the faith with you, this journey to God with you, you're going to get very frustrated. Very frustrated. And it takes a toll on you, I know. But what do you do in this case? You run away? You leave your family and you run away? You take refuge in the mountain? You don't do that. The prophets of God did not run away from their communities, except one, which I'm going to mention his story. And he saw the consequences of his deeds. Allah says, I sent you, if you are a good Muslim, then show me here, show me the goodness of your faith by staying with your family, by showing them good akhlaq, by showing them humility. Even if they are friends, sometimes family members, sometimes friends. Don't run away from them. If they are not violent against you, if they are violent, you have to stay away. Because you never know what happens. Nowadays, ISIS are distributing, you know, these straps. So they could join ISIS any minute and I don't know what happens. If they are not violent, if they are not violent, stay. Stay with them. Allah says, we send you to connect. You guys here, all the mu'mineen and mu'minat, you are bridge builders, connectors, connectors. Peacemakers. This is our duty. A mu'min who loves his Lord, who has a good relationship with his or her Lord, is a bridge builder. He brings people together. He stays in the family. Through your patience, through your tolerance, sometimes through your concessions, sometimes concessions. Someone used to go to his family, and the family are non-Muslim, and he stands for the Salat with the loudest voice, Allahu Akbar, Bismillah Rahman. And his father and his mother cannot sleep, they cannot go to work following him. So I was telling him, listen, do you want to worship God? Worship Him silently. You don't have to raise your voice. You are not the Imam of Masjid al-Haram. You are praying by yourself in the room. You don't have to raise your voice. Allah can hear you. Believe me, Allah has a very good ears. He can hear you. If you pray silently, He hears you. You don't have to raise your voice. Do not offend them. Some people think that since they are Muslims, they have to be angry. They have to push Islam down the throat of people. Like Saudi Arabia. Salah, salah, salah. At the time of salah, they carry the stick and they go on the shops and they break the window. Salah, salah, salah. Believe me, when you break the window of a shopkeeper, not only he's not going to pray, he's not going to believe in God anymore. Because he knows God as a God of mercy, not God of punishment. But this is the way Saudi Arabia works. This is the way. This is why we have ISIS in Saudi Arabia. Salat, invite people. وَأْمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاصْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا. Allah says to Ibrahim, ask them to pray. But give concessions. Be lenient. وَاصْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا. Be tolerant. Don't use force. You are not going to teach your children Islam or Salat or fasting or hijab through force, through intimidation, through anger. You are going to lose your family. Don't do that. You know how many parents, they drive their children away from God. Parents. They drive their children away from God because they are angry. We have to make God a beautiful God, the God of mercy. Even if your son skips the prayers today, tell him, no, no problem. You can make it up later. Don't send him to Jahannam immediately. Allah is the Lord of mercy. Allah has created وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضِ. A paradise that's unlimited. Only for a few hundred people like us, we go to paradise, and then the rest of paradise is empty. Is empty? No, it's not like that. So those people, you have to stay in your family. If your family are disobedient, they are not practicing, even if they radical Islam, be patient. Do not leave them. Otherwise, Anbiya Allah, they would have fled their communities, but none of them fled except one, and he made a grave mistake. وَذَنُّونِ إِذْ ذَهَبَ مُغَاضِبًا فَظَنَّ أَنْ لَنْ نَقْدِرَ عَلَيْهِ. He thought that we are not going to restrict him. Allah said to him, Yunus, you stay here in Nineveh, which is Mosul, which is captured now by ISIS, the same Mosul today. He was the prophet of that city. And he was buried there, and ISIS came. The first thing they did, they demolished his grave. The poor guy. So Allah said to him, stay in this area and preach and work for me. Invite people. But because they insisted on wrongdoing, injustice, kufr, rejecting God, one day he got angry and he left. He left. There were only two people who believed in him. One was a scholar, learned. The other was not scholar, jahil. So he left. When the adab approached the city of Nineveh, the people woke up, they realized that all these warnings that were made by Yunus were true. The adab is coming, the punishment is coming. So they went to those two guys. First, they went to the jahil. They said to him, where is Yunus? He said, listen, Yunus fled the city. You're going to go to hell. Go and prepare yourself for death. There is no solution. God is coming after him. They left him. They went to the alim. Look at the alim. This is the alim. They said, where is Yunus? He said, what do you want from Yunus? They said, we want to repent. He said, إِن لَمْ يَكُنْ يُونُسُ مَوْجُودًا فَرَبُّ يُونُسُ مَوْجُودًا. Yunus is a human being. If Yunus has fled, His Lord would not flee. His Lord is there. You have to go to His Lord. What do you want from yours? Leave Him alone. His Lord is there. Go to His Lord immediately. He gives hope. This is the alim. The hadith says the scholar is the one الذي لا ييئس الناس من رحمة الله. The good scholar is the one who does not make people despair or despondent from God's mercy. He finds them a way, a solution. That's the scholar. Yunus went, a moment of hunger. He's a human being. وَلَنُّونِ إِذْ ذَهَبَ مُغَاضِبًا فَظَنَّ أَنْ لَنْ نَقْدِرَ عَلَيْهِ. Naqdir means we do not restrict him. We do not discipline him. We discipline him. Because he left his post. He should have stayed there. You leave your post, you leave your job. فَنَادَى فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ سُبْحَانَكَ إِنِّي كُنْتُ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ وَنَجَّيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْغَمِّ وَكَذَلِكَ نُنْجِي الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. The hadith says, if you have a problem in your life, you can't find a solution, if you are depressed, if you are lonely, if you have something very serious, always say this. Subhanaka la ilaha illa ant. Inni kuntu minal zalimin. Subhanaka la ilaha illa ant. Inni kuntu minal zalimin. Because the hadith says, fastajabna lahu. We delivered him. We responded to him, we delivered him, and hence we deliver every true believer. وَكَذَلِكَ نُنْجِي الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. If you say the same, if you are distressed, unhappy, sad, no one is helping you, go to the source of help. إِنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ يُونُسُ مَوْجُودًا فَرَبُّ يُونُسُ مَوْجُودًا. Allah is there. Allah is there. Allah does not leave His post. He's there. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. Sustain your family. Be the source of connection. Maybe one day your family will wake up. Maybe your family will wake up. I end with this story. Musa alayhi salam was so frustrated with Pharaoh. So frustrated. Musa says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وقال موسى in Surah Yunus, وقال موسى ربنا إنك آتيت فرعون وملئه زينة وأموالا في الحياة الدنيا. ربنا إنك آتيت فرعون وملئه زينة وأموالا في الحياة الدنيا. You have given them زينة, wealth, power, influence, وأموالا, good economy. في الحياة الدنيا ربنا ليضلوا عن سبيلك. They are using this influence, this power, this military might, this strong economy to misguide people from your path. ليضلوا عن سبيلك. So he became angry. Listen to what he said to God. ربنا اطمس على أموالهم. My Lord, I want you to destroy their wealth, their economy. Destroy it. وَشْتُدْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ. The first dua, the first curse is easy. But listen to the second one. Second one is very hard. This is where Allah reprimanded Musa for this dua. Allah reprimanded him. رَبَّنَا اطْمِسْ عَلَىٰ أَمْوَالِهِمْ. Destroy their economy. Okay, destroy their economy, no problem. But he said something inappropriate here. وَشْتُدْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ فَلَا يُؤْمِنُوا حَتَّى يَرَوُوا الْعَذَابَ الْأَلِيمِ. Harden their hearts so they cannot be ever guided until they get that severe punishment from you. This is not good. You have to pray. Even for your enemies, you have to say, Ilahi, if they are qualified to believe, guide them. Let them be guided. Don't destroy them. If they are not qualified, they still insist on their injustice, and their wrongdoings, and on their evil, then destroy them. But Musa did not do that. So Allah sent a message to Musa. At the time where Fir'aun was drowning, Fir'aun started calling on Musa, "Musa, please, help!" Musa was standing there and laughing at him. Allah said to Musa, "Believe me, Musa, if Fir'aun was raising his head and saying, 'Allah,' I would have saved him. I would have saved him. Even though I know he's corrupt, but if he calls upon me and says, 'I need help,' I would have helped him. How could you did not listen to him?" This is not the message of someone whose heart is full of love and compassion. So stay in your community, stay in your family. People need saving. People need guidance. Try to reach out to them. Maybe Allah has chosen you. He said, "I want you to be my messenger here. I have chosen from all those people, I want you. To be the means that I carry, I send my guidance to people." Stay there and extend your hand, extend your heart. And this is the month of Ramadan, the month of Rahmah, the month of compassion. Allahumma aghfir lil mu'minin wal mu'minat wal muslimin wal muslimat al ahya'i minhum wal amwat. تابع اللهم بيننا وبينهم بالخيرات إنك مجيب الدعوات إنك غافر الخطيئات تقبل منا صلاتنا وصيامنا ودعاءنا في هذا الشهر العظيم ومن على مرضانا بالشفاء والعافية. We have a friend of us, Mahmoud Rida, who comes on wheelchair always. He's in a bad shape and his father told me that we really need to pray for him. He was always in the masjid, always. You see him during Friday prayers, most of the night. So let's, for him and other mu'mineen and other who need dua, whether they are patients, whether they are, you know, people who are distressed, raise your hand, let's pray for them. A'udhu billahi minash shaytan ar-rajim. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء 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 أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. يا الله اللهم اكشف السوء عنا. اللهم انصر الإسلام والمسلمين. اللهم اكشف السوء عن المؤمنين والمسلمين في كل مكان يا أرحم الراحمين. تقبل منا أعمالنا في هذا الشهر العظيم, صلاتنا وصيامنا, ووفقنا للتوبة والعبادة يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم كن لوليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة, وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا, حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا. واجعلنا اللهم من أنصاره وأعوانه وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات والشهداء. ثواب الفاتحة مع الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد.